Sunday. Welcome, welcome to Unity. Welcome, live streamers. Hello, hello. Happy Sunday.
Standing outside the door, love and mercy. You wonder if there's a place here for you. You know there's peace inside, but still you're searching for someone who understands the pain that you've been through. The lights on. What are you waiting for? Come on in, welcome home. You are love, you belong. Ain't I? No matter where you've been, just come on in. Ooh. You find a place of rest in the arms of spirit. God is waiting. Come on in, welcome home. You
And good morning, everybody. Come on in to your living room or your car or wherever you may be watching us this morning, but be part of this spiritual community based out of Unity of Pompano Beach. And we are here keeping the sanctuary alive with our wonderful energy that we always enjoy here. And we invite you into the midst of that today. I'm Bev Spivey. I co-minister here with my husband, Reverend Lawrence Palmer, and it's our joy to be with you this morning as we welcome each and every one of you. We also welcome our wonderful professional musicians under the direction of James McCoy.
We're so grateful to be here. Thank you so much. We have Mr. John Rose at the piano once again, Mr. Orlando Machado at the drum set once again, and our featured soloist is Karina Iglesias. And this morning we have music from Burt Bacharach, Michael Jackson, and we're going to go all the way back to the 80s for one of the songs. So I don't want to give it away right now, but I know all of you, if you were children of the 80s, you will know this song.
And today we bring our mind and our thoughts together. And during this pandemic, we are each doing what we can as we focus on community today. And our theme for the entire year has been that of perfect vision, seeing through a spiritual lens. As we look at all of the things around us, all of the challenges that you may be facing, all of the challenges that we are all facing in one way or another, and we lift ourselves up to not be drawn in by fear, to allow that love to express through us in whatever way it can. So we continue to look at life through a spiritual lens. And would you believe the theme for April, which was chosen back in the fall across the Unity Worldwide movement, the theme for April is interconnection. Interconnection. As we focus on, indeed, how we are all connected through community. So the affirmation that we use here, and if you are a member here on our prayer cycle for this month, you will have received a little affirmation card in the mail. So the affirmation is, like rivers flowing from one source, we are all connected. Won't you hold that in your mind with me as I say it again? Like rivers flowing from one source, we are all connected. And so let's feel that connection now as we take a few moments for prayer, for centering ourselves into this day, as we let go of whatever's going on in our household or wherever we are this morning. Perhaps you're on a Facebook watch party. Let go of all of the connections that you have been buzzing around with this morning, and now feel that connection in your heart. Let's close our eyes to take out distractions. Feel that heart connection with each other in your circle of family and friendships, and broadening out that connection to include South Florida, throughout our state, throughout the Northeast, and then across through the Midwest, all the way to the West Coast, and then all the way around the entire world. As we feel our love for the global community, as we declare patience for enduring what we know we must, and as we declare love, we are interconnected, and so it is. Amen.
What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there is just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. There are oceans sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. Oh, we don't need another man. There are cornfields and wheat fields enough to grow. There are sunbeams and moonbeams enough to shine. Would you listen, Lord? Oh, if you want to, Lord. Now, what the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there is just too little of. What the world needs now is love. Just for some, oh, but just for every one.
Thank you, Karina. And I know we are each touched to know that we all have love that we can give, that we can share. So I invite you to keep that in your mind as we continue on today. I want to welcome all of you who are with us on our live stream. It's through our website at unitypompanobeach.org. And this live stream will be on that website all week long until we override it next Sunday. I know some on Sunday mornings, especially, the internet is just bombarded with so many churches broadcasting and so many families having Zoom meetings and everything else. So if you're having internet difficulties, know that our complete service is on live stream and it will stay there for you to listen any number of times that you would like all week. Use that for your boost every day if you need it, definitely throughout the week. Stay in touch with your spirit and the love within you. So if you are on Facebook this morning, I also have good news for you. For all of you, our Facebook page is Unity of Pompano Spiritual Center. We are doing Facebook Live, and we have been, thanks to Ron Smith managing our camera here. We know that the voice, the audio is not great because we are in a huge sanctuary of 350 seats, and it's empty. Except for us, so it's echoey. But I think Lawrence has figured out a solution with James and John and others. We hope to have excellent audio for you next week on Facebook Live as we run it through our soundboard here. So wherever you are and however you are watching, we welcome your comments on Facebook. We also invite you to go to our website to keep up with all our activities, our events. We have everything going now on Zoom. We also have a prayer request line there. We encourage you to put your prayer requests in and have our chaplains and me and Lawrence pray with you. We also have a contact us form there that you can write in anything you may need from us and keep in touch that way. So our Facebook and our website, we are so very grateful for that we had them ready to go as we started into this pandemic. Let's see what we have today. We have Power Hour, which has been continuing every week now with a Zoom meeting, and we invite you to attend that. Power Hour begins at 9:30 on Sunday mornings and goes till 10:30. It's led by our wonderful licensed teacher, Cynthia Roberts. We ask that you register. Zoom and others have cautioned us about hacking and other misuses of Zoom meetings, and that's why we require you to register so that you can get the link. So that's Power Hour. Something new we're adding this week that was the brainchild of our ministry leader of the prayer chaplains, Dina Schimmick, and all the chaplains want to have a meditation time for you. It will be Thursday evenings at 7 p.m. every week. Again, you must register on Zoom. All our registrations begin with our website. So if you go on our website, you will see the link there.
And that will take you to the registration page, which is very simple. Just name, email, and phone. And then you will be all set to receive the link for that wonderful meditation. It will just be 30 minutes or so after everybody gets on the call. And one of our chaplains is going to be leading you through that wonderful, refreshing, centering time every Thursday night. Last of all, I want to let you know that I will be teaching another Unity credit class. It's also a class that you don't need to take for credit. So all of you are welcome into this. It's called 12 Powers. It's one of the original Unity teachings that came out in the very early 1900s through our founder, Charles Fillmore. It links up the mind ideas that we have into power, like strength and love, imagination, 12 of them. And they are positioned in the body around the chakras. They are also connected to colors. They are also connected to Jesus' disciples, each one representing a power. So this is a very interesting course. I will be teaching it on Zoom for 6 weeks, beginning May 5th. The cost for the course is $60, which if you're familiar with other online courses, this is deeply discounted, for we want those of you who have financial challenges right now to join us. So $60 for the 6 week course. If you know you're not able to be available for the whole course, but you would like to sit in on a class or two, that would be a $10 fee. And you're able to do that when you register through our website. For those of you that want to mail a check to the office here or to use bill pay, both of those are, and also to use ACH. The bill pay and mailing the check, of course, except for the cost of your personal stamp if you mail it yourself, the bank will do it for you on bill pay, and there's no charge to you or to us. But however you register, we welcome you into that class. I am really looking forward to it. It will be taught on Zoom. So now, when we usually have our greeting time, once again, stretch out your arms. Imagine everyone here giving you a hug and a handshake and a smile. And let's feel the interconnection of our spiritual community.
Good morning. I have the privilege of sharing with you our daily word this morning. And the word for today is understanding. I open myself to spiritual understanding. When I feel frustrated by a personal or professional challenge, or feel unsafe or concerned about a situation or event, I seek greater understanding. When I try to understand, I open my heart. Maybe I just need to gather more information or request the advice of someone I trust. If I am in conflict with someone, I practice understanding by listening with a curious mind and a loving heart. I grow in spiritual understanding when I discern and heed my inner guidance. Beyond conscious thought, spiritual truth begins to illuminate my consciousness. As I release all that stands in the way of understanding and stand firm in the love that calls it forth, I am guided by my growing spiritual understanding. And from Psalms 119, your decrees are righteous forever. Give me understanding that I may live.
Right now, we'd like to begin a time of prayer and meditation by singing, "You Know the Truth Is You."
And familiar position for your body. And wherever you may be, whether you are completely alone or with family, I invite you to imagine being back here in this space that you're so comfortable in and familiar with. And imagine that spiritually, consciously, we are joined together, even though physically apart. And imagine that there is a golden cord that connects us, a spiritual cord that knows no distance and no time. And each of us can hold that cord, and we are united in spirit. So I invite you again to give your body permission to relax, to let go, to let be. Give your mind permission from thinking, planning, and allow your awareness to be free for communion with Spirit. And I invite you to open your mind and your heart to understanding. Open your being to a new experience, a new touch in the stillness, a new awareness, a new sense of the presence of Spirit. Open your mind. open your heart, engage your awareness, and let this be your time, exactly what you need, just for you. So as we have prepared ourselves, let us join together now in the stillness. Now, as you prepare to return your awareness to your body, this time and your space, you know that even an instant during which your awareness is immersed in that deep of your heart, that healing and transformation take place. And you know that you can bring into your body, your mind, your heart, the essence of this experience. And in this coming week, as you choose to or need to, you can recall this experience and be blessed once again. So with a deep sense of gratitude for this experience together, I invite you to take a deep, slow breath in through your nose, hold it for a moment, and very deliberately breathe out through your mouth. When you're ready, open your eyes and let us join together in singing Alleluia.
Hallelujah.
Right now we'd like to do the song from the 80s. I know you're all going to know, everyone knows this song, but it's the song that says, there's a choice we're making, we're saving our own lives. So keep that in mind.
Oh, my goodness, man. Thank you again for a job well done. Wonderful. James grinned all the way through that song. Very good. One of the things I learned very early on after becoming a minister at the ripe old age of 22 was that part of my job was to have a sense of what was on the minds and the hearts of the people sitting in front of me and to address those concerns, those thoughts that were in their minds. And it didn't take a lot of thought to figure out what is on most people's minds right now, and that is dealing with this coronavirus and being in the middle of this pandemic. So I thought it was time for me to take a few moments and speak about that directly. I know you're hearing it ad nauseum on television and radio and on your computers and everywhere else, but we need to take a very careful spiritual look at what this experience is all about. In 1776, Thomas Paine, writing under the pseudonym Common Sense, wrote a series of pamphlets to inspire and to support and encourage all those who were involved in the revolution against Great Britain. He wrote a whole series of pamphlets designed for that. And in 1776, during the winter, before the Battle of Trenton, he said, "These are the times that try men's souls." And that comes back to haunt us in a way even today, because down through the years, there have been many times in our history that there have been experiences that tried men's souls, humankind's souls, and so is it for today. As we look back, we've been through wars, supposedly the war to end all wars. We've been through financial crises. We've been through real estate crises. We've been through medical and health crises along the way. And here we are now in the midst of the coronavirus, once again, facing a situation that tries our soul. Thomas Paine also said, "Tyranny, like hell, is not easily conquered, yet we have this consolation with us, that the harder the conflict, the more glorious the triumph." And I'd like for you to put those words in the back of your mind as we share this time this morning. The harder the conflict, the more glorious the triumph. Now, as we experience this coronavirus in a lot of different ways. For some people, it's like watching something else happen. For others, it's come very close to home. And even in our own church family, we've lost one of our own dear souls to the effects of the coronavirus. So we've been touched by it directly. And in the middle of that, one of the things that we want to do is to say, why? We want to know, why is this happening? How did this come to be? How do we find ourselves in this situation? Why in the world is it happening? And I am not going to offer anything along that line of telling you why. Brain research has shown us that one of the most important needs that the brain has, both human and animal, is that of certainty. The brain needs the information to process, to know what's going to happen, to predict what's going to happen so that we know ahead of time how we're going to behave and what's the right thing to do. And in this situation we find ourselves in with the coronavirus, we don't have that information and our brains are screaming for it. And it's uncomfortable not having that information. One of the things that happens when we don't have the information that we need is we turn to hang on to whatever we can. And very often what we hang on to is fear, because that's very easy and it's very common. We not only feel afraid, but we become afraid. And there's a great difference in those two things, of feeling afraid and being afraid. And my concern is that there are a lot of people now out in the world dealing with this coronavirus from the point of being afraid. And it sounds kind of crude to say it, but I've said it many times to other people that when somebody's afraid, they get stupid. And that happens over and over again. We've seen it, that the way people behave. It's so ridiculous, and we behave without any kind of reason about it. People have gone to the grocery stores and they're hoarding toilet paper and rice and beans. I heard the stories about two women getting in a fist fight over a bag of rice in a grocery store. Another story about a man and a woman struggling with each other over a package of toilet paper. When we get afraid, when we become afraid, we get stupid and we do things that we wouldn't ordinarily do. And this is not really stupid. I'm not calling it that because it was a tragedy. But there was a bishop of a church who said that God is bigger than the virus. And I talked to God and refused to comply with the protocols of the coronavirus time. And he gathered his church together. And not long after that, he contracted the virus and died from it. And that's a very sad thing. I'm certainly not making light of that whatsoever. But when we are afraid, when we are being afraid, we do things that go beyond common sense and what we would usually, the ways that we would usually behave. So we seek information. We want to know what's going on, even though we don't know, and in a sense, we can't know. So we latch on to fear. Now, there's a lyrics of an old rock and roll song. I think it was, may have been Janis Joplin, who said that even a bad love is better than no love at all. And even being able to feel fear is better for a lot of people than feeling nothing. But nevertheless, it is there. We also get mean when we are afraid. We get crazy when we are afraid. And we run away from things that we should be facing, things that we should be addressing, things that we should be dealing with up front. But we don't because of that being afraid. And again, I want to emphasize the difference in feeling afraid and being afraid. We become angry when we are afraid, when that becomes a part of us. And we seek people to blame as well. That reminds me of a story. There was a psychiatrist who was giving one of his patients the Rorschach ink blot test. And he showed the gentleman a picture, and the guy said, "That's a naked man." Showed him another picture, and he said, "That's a naked woman." Showed him another picture and said, "That's the naked woman and naked man in bed together." And the psychiatrist stopped and said, "Sir, you seem to have a preoccupation with sex." And the man said, "Well, you're the one having all the dirty pictures to show me." So we want to have somebody to blame. It's your fault that this is happening. But there's plenty of blame to go around. There's people everywhere that are involved in this. There have been mistakes made all along the way. There are many things that should have been done that weren't done, things that shouldn't have been done that were done, and we find ourselves where we are. And hopefully we will certainly learn from that. But there's no one really to blame to satisfy us. So that emptiness continues because we don't have the information. We don't really know what's going on. So it seems useless then to spend a lot of time on that question. Why is this happening? Why do we find ourselves in this situation? The other question that's more appropriate than asking why is, we're in this situation now. What are we going to do about it? What is it that we are called to do during this time of challenge when we can't answer the question, why? Now, I have invented a new word. I think I've invented it. I've never heard it before. That is awarefraid. Awarefraid. That's a combination of awareness and afraid. And this is what I mean by not being afraid, yet acknowledging fear. Fear is an appropriate feeling. If you're walking down the street and you look up and here's a 180-pound Rottweiler foaming at the mouth, growling, snarling, coming at you, fear is a very appropriate response in that particular time. But living afraid of every time you hear a dog barking, you go into a panic attack, is not healthy at all. So if we can recognize when it's time to feel fear and to feel it with awareness, that's what I mean by aware afraid, is that we feel the fear, but we have the awareness to know what's going on within ourselves. So we have a threat to our lifestyle. We have a threat in the form of the virus to our health. And it is certainly appropriate to feel fear in this situation, but we don't need to be fear. Say, "I feel the fear of this situation, and here is how I'm going to act appropriately. I'm going to do what needs to be done here from a rational, clear point of view." So let's think about being aware afraid in this time where we acknowledge the fear of the situation, yet manage it with appropriate awareness. Now, some of the things that we've been told to do and I think are good for us to do is to see that whatever information we have is good information. And I say this really not being sarcastic, but being painfully honest and open about it. If you're looking for good information about the coronavirus, don't get it from a layperson. Get it from a doctor. There are plenty of people out there who have camera time now who want to tell you what to do and what's going on, and they don't know. There are people on television. There are politicians who are trying to tell you the way things are, and they don't know. But the doctors do know a little bit. Anyone who does know something about the virus is going to be a professional and expert. So when you get your information, don't get it off of a late night talk show. Don't get it off of a celebrity's show. Don't get it from your brother-in-law's cousin's aunt. But get it from an expert if you're going to get it at all. And when you get that information, act appropriately. We've been given some protocols about keeping social distance, about staying at home as much as we can, washing our hands. Those are good, practical, solid things to do. And I was reminded as I was thinking about this that the original name of the Unity Movement was the Unity Church of Practical Christianity. And it is practical for us to follow the protocols to protect ourselves and be careful about how we expose ourselves. So what are we going to do in the midst of this? We're going to be smart. We're going to get good information as good information is available, and we're going to follow the protocols that are there for us. Another thing that we can do during this time is look to the future. Look forward from where we are here. Now again, what we often do is when a situation is in front of us that's not desirable, something that's uncomfortable, something unpleasant, even something that, like the virus, is dangerous, when it's over, what we tend to do is want to go back. Let's go back to where we were. Let's take the financial situation back to where it was before all this happened. Let's take our social situation back to where it was before. There is no going back. We will never be the same after this. At least I know from my own generation that we've never seen anything or had to deal with anything like this coronavirus. And when this is over, whenever that happens and however it happens, we will not be the same. The world will not be the same. The situation will not be the same. This virus is non-discriminatory. I know that I remember back when this first came out and we heard about the virus going on in China, when I got a call that my class reunion in May was canceled, I thought, why are we canceling? That's in May. That's no problem. And then I found out that Nehemiah Week, which is what I was going to be participating in this week at Unity Village, was canceled. And I thought, why are we canceling Nehemiah Week? We can go and do what we're supposed to do. When that first came out, it was somewhere else. It was involving the Chinese, so we're safe. Well, when it spread to a couple of other countries, and it became a pandemic. And then all of a sudden, it was like, well, it'll be everywhere but here. And then when it came here, it's like, well, it's in another state, but not my state. Then it's like in somebody else's city, but not my city. Somebody else's community, not my community. And before you know it, we're all in this thing together. And it's been a long time since the humankind has been united in any way like this. So there is no going back. We will never be the same after this, and I think that's a good thing. Because we are encouraged in Scripture and the teachings of unity to look forward, to move to take the awareness, the knowledge, the experience we have from this and take it with us to create something that has never have been, that never has been before. After we have had time to do things different socially, after we've had time to do things different financially, globally, let's take that information and move into something new, something that has never been before. I've been thinking a lot about this for my own personal life, is that as we move forward, what about our health? And I've noticed that despite my proclamation a number of years ago that I have withdrawn my conscious participation in the aging process, my body has not gotten that message completely yet. It's coming along. I mean, you'd never believe I was 95. But I'm working on that. And part of what has come to me lately is looking at the future from the point of hyper health. That is bringing our body to that place that Charles and Myrtle Fillmore talked about, a place where spirit controls our body and not our ego. Spirit controls the processes in our body and not the default setting that we have in our body from human race consciousness. I'm going to say more about that at a later time, not today, but hyper health, so be on the watch for that. And also looking at what I call a hybrid human. You know, there are hybrid cars now that have both electric and gasoline engines in them. And I think that we can become a hybrid human by bringing more and more spirit into expression in this three-dimensional experience. So those two things kind of go together that we can look at sometime in the future. But let us move to the future without fear, without being afraid. Let us move into the future with aware afraid, where we bring together our acknowledgement of the feeling of fear along with the awareness of what the truth is and the truth of our spiritual beingness. We can move forward with being with optimism, with hope, and with possibility. Possibility is something good for us to hang on to during this time. When I lived in Colorado, we had several really, really huge forest fires there. Devastating. It burned so many acres and acres, thousands, hundreds of thousands of acres, actually. But something happened interesting. Those areas that were burned never returned to the way they were before, but they turned into something else. I found out after one of those huge fires, I was listening to a documentary about it. They were talking about the fact that there are plants that will grow after a fire that never would grow otherwise. There are certain things that get burned and cause germination. So in those places where those forest fires raged, in a few years there was new growth, brand new growth that came out of the midst of that devastation. And what came after the fire was different than what was before the fire, and sometimes even better than before. So we look at this possibility for us. Could it be that after this horrible time that we've gone through, that what emerges from this will be better than what was before? Could it be that what comes after this we'll be better prepared for anything in the future than we ever were before? And could it be that individually we can hold a consciousness that is stronger and deeper than ever before? This is the possibility that lies before us. And in our thinking and in our speaking, the Pope Francis in his Easter Sunday address said this: indifference, self-centeredness, division, and forgetfulness are not words we want to hear at this time. We want to ban these words forever. And to keep our mind focused on that which is true, that which is positive, that which is optimistic, that which is hopeful. Not to ignore what the fact is. Not to ignore the feeling of fear, but to acknowledge that I am not the fear. I am living in aware afraid. I encourage you to use that word this week. So I'd like to close with this. John's going to put a graphic up on your screen. And someone gave a metaphysical twist to COVID-19, which is the name was given the coronavirus. And you'll see on the graphic that co is a prefix which means together with. And vid is a Latin root word meaning see. And 19, if you do the numerology on it, 1 plus 9 is 10, and 10 is 1 plus 0 equals 1. So if you look at COVID-19 in a certain way, it tells you together see oneness. So in the midst of this time that tries our soul, let us together see oneness. Together see oneness. God bless you.
And as we have a wonderful closing number for you, we call attention to giving. One thing in unity that we remain firm on is the fact that as we give, we receive. So whether it's the idea of hoarding groceries or toilet paper, whatever that might be, have enough for yourself, but also give out. And I know so many of you have let us know such good stories, how you are reaching out to each other with little Zoom gatherings and making food and dropping it off, and so many ways that we can give. We are happy to announce here that before we knew we were really going to be hit with this virus, the board voted to send money a month ago to Broward Outreach Center to assist with their feeding program at Easter time and other times. So we had sent them $100. But now, since all of this has hit, and you have been generous in your giving to us, and we have scaled way back on our expenses, we decided to step on out there in faith with our giving, and the board voted on Thursday night to send what a portion of ours that usually would go to some other places within the Unity movement. We continue to send to our Unity World headquarters at Unity Village, and we continue to send to Unity World Worldwide Ministries, which is our association of churches. You see, it doesn't matter whether we make a profit or not. We always give 10% of our gross income, and we want you to know that because we believe that's what has sustained us. Some months we're in the red, but overall we stay in the black. So this month we have decided to send $500 to Feeding South Florida, because food for the many who really, really need it is in desperate supply. They normally get from restaurants, from nonprofits who donate, from overage in a number of places, and all of those sources are not as abundant as they had been. So it's up to us, isn't it? So as you receive your stimulus checks, of course, take what you need for yourself and to stimulate our economy to help bring it back. But be aware that we have a little tool that we use called unexpected income. And when we get unexpected income, we always give 10% of that. So if you can, think about giving 10% of your stimulus check to some source that is giving you spiritual nourishment. We would encourage your giving here, of course, at Unity of Pompano, and we continue to provide instruction through classes and through meditation times to be in the midst of peace. So many ways that we encourage your giving today. And on the screen there is a ways to give through our website, of course, unitypompanobeach.org, where you may use an ACH debit to your account or credit card. You may always mail in a check, of course. You may use your bill pay to have your bank send us your gift. And you can, all of these things, set them up as recurring or one time only. There's also texting that you may set yourself up to simply text a gift to us. We can't tell you how thrilled we have been as we started into this, realizing we weren't going to be able to be passing the offering plate. We can't tell you how happy we are with your giving. Thank you. Those who were never able to give very much are still giving. Those who were able to give more are giving that more so that we can cover those of you who can't. So our hearts go out to each and every one of you, and we thank you. We let you know, too, if you're shopping on Amazon, don't forget to sign up for Amazon Smile, which is smile.amazon.com, and they send us a portion of their donation to charitable organizations. So we just want you to know how thrilled we are that life continues on here. And I remember Myrtle Fillmore, our founder, who, they were in the Unity movement in the Depression times of the early 1900s, and she is quoted as saying, to the fear that was around them about what they were going to do to continue Unity, and she said, let us not hope that the money holds out. Let us hope that our faith holds out. We believe in the prosperity of this abundant world in many different forms, and we thank you for your gift. And now, some music.
There
There's a place in your heart, and I know that it is love. And this place could be much brighter than tomorrow. And if you really try, you'll find there's no need to cry. In this place, you'll feel there's no hurt or sorrow. There are ways to get there. If you care enough for the living, make a little space, make a better place. Heal the world. Place for you and for me. If you want to know why there is love that cannot lie, love is strong, it only cares of joyful giving. If we try, we shall see in this bliss we cannot feel. Fear of dread, we stop existing and start living. Then it feels it always. Love's enough for us growing to make a better world. To make a better world. Heal the world. It's plain to see this world is heavenly. Big birds grow, we could fly so high. Let our spirits never die. In my heart, I feel you are all my brothers. Create a world with no fear. Together we'll cry happy tears. See the nations turn their swords into plowshares. Really get there. If you care enough for the living, make a little space to make a better place. Heal the world.
Heal the world.
And that's where we are today. If it's going to be, it's up to me, is an old phrase you may have heard. And indeed, God expresses through us. So it's up to us to hold that high watch for each and every person. Right now, our chaplains are listening to this service. We have 15 of them, 16 of them actually. And they would be happy to hold your prayer requests in their heart, in their prayer time every day, this coming week and beyond. So take advantage of our prayer request form on our website and go ahead and let us know how we may pray with you. And so we come to the close. If you're familiar with Unity Services, you may know the prayer for protection. We invite you wherever you are to reach out your arms and bless each and every person in this whole world. Together, the light of God surrounds us. We are the light of God. The love of God enfolds us. We are the love of God. The power of God protects us. We are the power of God. The presence of God watches over us. We are the presence of God. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.
Stand.